This is a video on how to fix your credit score in less than a month, as well as keep it high in the future. But before I tell you how, I need to tell you why. I'm not a financial expert, and I'm not selling you any product. I'm simply a stand-up comedian who thought that credit scores were a predatory practice. So I did a bunch of research on how to use that system to your advantage. Why listen to me? Well, my credit score used to be in the low 600s, and now it's over 800. I know how this works. And heads up, I'm an American, so I'm generally talking about American credit scores. But this information can potentially apply to other countries and their laws as well. Credit scores are generally used to determine your creditworthiness, i.e. whether or not a lender determines you worthy of a loan. Yeah, worthy. That's the word they use. Credit scores are important when you're trying to get a credit card, or buy a car, rent an apartment, pretty much anything you're trying to do that doesn't involve cash. And considering the vast majority of us don't just have a few million lying around, that means our credit reports can determine where we live, what we drive, even what job we have. That's right. Almost 3/4 of employers run credit checks on potential employees. The employers don't see your credit score, but they do see the items on your report that make up that score. Businesses do that based on the idea that the more debt someone has, the more likely they are to steal from them. Particularly ironic because of how many companies use debt as part of how they make money. But more on that later. Your credit score is actually your FICO score. And FICO isn't some acronym for some kind of government organization, like the Financial Institution of Colonial Oafs. FICO is a private data analytics company. It was founded by guys named Fair and Isaacs, hence Fair and Isaacs Company. FICO. They make over $1 billion a year selling our credit score to banks, private companies, and consumers. And when did FICO scores start? 1989. That's right, the FICO score, which governs every aspect of most of our lives, is 10 years younger than I am. FICO keeps their billion-dollar formula a secret in order to keep banks, businesses, and us needing them. And while I get that's good business, that also keeps most people guessing at what earns them a good score. And that is simply unfair. Imagine if we had to take our driver's test without ever being allowed to learn what the laws of the road actually were. Some of us would still pass based on instinct or guesswork, but most of us would be stuck taking the bus. And that would keep the roads traffic-free for insiders. That is what credit scores do. But more on that later. Do you think that you start with a perfect score and can damage it as you go on? Wrong. Do you think that never having credit card debt would help your score? Wrong. Do you think that having a huge income-to-debt ratio would help your score? Wrong. Do you think that paying down your mortgage quickly helps your score? Wrong. So much of credit scores are counterintuitive. Let me break it down for you. There are 5 basic categories that go into a credit score. Length of credit history, debt burden, types of credit used, recent credit searches, and, most importantly, payment history. So here are some tips on how to use those to your advantage. Length of credit history means the average age of your credit accounts, as well as the oldest account. This category makes up 15% of your score, and it is completely counterintuitive. I understand the idea that the longer you've shown yourself to be worthy of loans, the more likely it is that you'll get a loan. But it also means that you get punished for closing old unused accounts. Do you have a credit card you don't use anymore? If there's no annual fee, keep it open. In fact, my advice is that when you turn 18, open a couple of free credit card accounts, and then shred the cards immediately. Don't spend a dime, but merely having those accounts open will help you get a loan in the future. Debt burden is a big one. This is 30% of your score and the formula that FICO keeps the most secretive. It's basically how much you owe as compared to how much you could owe. And the lower that percentage, the better. In other words, if you owe $1,000 on a card with a $5,000 limit, that gets you a lower score than owing 5 times that amount on a card with a $30,000 limit. The less you owe compared to what you could owe, the higher your score. But it's not that simple. This part of your score also gets determined by a bunch of other things, like the number of accounts you carry balances on, and different types of credit, like a mortgage versus a credit card, etc. So how do you increase that score without owing a ton of money? It's not very complicated. Just increase your credit limit. Again, do not spend what you do not have. However, you can call your credit card company and just ask for a limit increase. Most of the time, they'll do it, no questions asked, because they want you to use their card. That is how they make money. And I will never recommend carrying any consumer credit card debt if it can be avoided. But if you do, try to keep it on one card. Then the other unused cards can help lower your score. Types of credit is another 10% of your score, and pretty simple. The more different types you have, the better your score. There are 3 main types of credit. Revolving credit, so credit cards and home equity loans, things like that. Installment credit, a mortgage, car loan, student loan, and open credit, like a charge card. So you're being rewarded for diversifying your credit, which makes sense. But how are you supposed to take out a mortgage if you don't have a high enough score because you haven't taken out a mortgage? You can't. Or if you can, your rate will be higher. I call this a catch-22% APR. They're making you prove your worthiness by charging you more. Recent credit searches is another part of the formula, and the dumbest one. You don't get penalized for doing something like checking your credit report, but you do for taking out a loan. That's right. When a bank checks your credit, the installment loan that you're about to take out, which will raise your score, temporarily lowers it. The good thing is that FICO considers all credit inquiries done in a two-week period the same. So if you're rate shopping on a mortgage, you only get dinged once. But let's say you get a mortgage in May and a car in August. Those both count against your score. Thankfully, this falls off your FICO score in a year, but come on. A lender checks your score, sees that it's great, and that somehow lowers your score, which could raise your interest rate. Are you starting to see how this might be predatory? The final category, payment history, makes up a whopping 35% of your score. This is where most people get hit. This includes the big things, like bankruptcies and foreclosures, but it also includes little things, like late payments on a credit card. I once got a store card from Old Navy. I was young and dumb and wanted 10% off a t-shirt. I was responsible, and I paid my bills on time, but I made the mistake of putting a typo on the payment amount. Now, that is my fault, but I owed that credit card company less than a dollar. And that late payment dragged my credit score down for years. Do not miss credit card payments, ever. Aside from emphasizing my previous advice of not ever borrowing money you can't pay back, if you do find yourself in that situation, making a minimum payment is incredibly important in not screwing up your score. The craziest part about payment history being such a big part of your score is that businesses miss payments purposefully all the time. It's called strategic default. Let's say a company buys a building and owes $2 million on the loan. Recession hits, or the neighborhood changes. For whatever reason, the company decides it can't operate at that location anymore. But the problem is, the $2 million building is now only worth $1.5. Does the company sell the building for a $500,000 loss? Hold on to the building and keep paying the loan in the hopes that it will eventually go back up? No. They simply stop paying. The bank will take the building back, and the company will be able to buy a new property without much issue. Meanwhile, if a consumer does it, guess what it does to their FICO score? This entire system is set up to reward rich people. It makes credit easier for them by making it tougher on everyone else. So now that you know all that, what can you do? I'll tell you what you can do. The three companies that report your credit worthiness to FICO are Experian, Equifax, and TransUnion, which seems like they were all named by a satirist making fun of generic businesses. I'm sorry, was Initech taken? Each of these businesses make your credit report available for free once a year. This isn't them being generous. They're legally mandated to do this, and they have been since 2003. That new law was a corollary to the Fair Credit Reporting Act. That law passed in 1970 before credit scores were even a thing. Just how predatory can lending be? America realized it had a big problem with companies and banks regarding consumer data, so they passed a law to protect it. The banks and FICO figured out how to get around that by turning your information into some sort of secret point system. And then the government again realized it had to do something about that. The government is giving an immense amount of power to FICO, Equifax, Experian, and TransUnion, while also realizing it has to protect people from FICO, Experian, Equifax, and TransUnion. And what makes it worse is that protection is pretty low. Companies can fraudulently report you to the credit bureaus, and there's no punishment for it. But that probably doesn't happen often, right? Wrong. A 2015 study found that 23% of consumers found inaccurate information on their credit report. And I actually find that number surprisingly low. And I'm not talking about my Old Navy credit card mess. While I was too young and naive to understand the implications of taking that credit card out, it was still my fault. But here's one that wasn't. I moved, and when I did, I returned my cable box to Comcast. On time, in good condition. But Comcast said I had two boxes, despite them never charging me the monthly fee that would have been triggered by a second box, having no record that I ever used a second box, and not having a serial number of this alleged second box. They billed me $900 for the lost equipment, and it took me over a year to clear it up. Meanwhile, guess what ended up on my credit report? A lot of us have fought incorrect charges from a phone company, health insurance, or a hotel that adds a parking charge when you don't have a car. I've dealt with all of these, and more. And let's say they refund you, as they usually do. If it took you over a month to get it settled, and you didn't pay it off meanwhile, that can ruin your credit. But I've got a way to fix it. One of the provisions of the Fair Credit Reporting Act gives the bureaus 30 calendar days to respond to a dispute. And if they miss that deadline, the dispute is removed. That's right, these massive companies that deal with almost a billion people a year have just 30 days to verify any dispute. Each bureau has a different process, which is outlined on their websites. Start with getting your report, which you can also do on each bureau's website. Find anything negative that you don't believe should be on your report and dispute it. You can do so online. Or, if you have the time, do it by mail, as that would take them longer to process. Not only do they need to take the time to verify the information, but so does the company that they're verifying with. And do you know whose job it is to do that? People that, for the most part, are just as negatively affected by credit scores as you. Yeah, sometimes things will stay in your report, and sometimes they will just disappear. like there are companies strategically defaulting on a $2 million property. There is one more trick. The more of us that file at once, the less likely the credit bureaus are to make the 30-day deadline. And as it turns out, there's a 2-week period in December where most offices don't get much work done. It took me 13 months to go from the 600s to the 800s, and I didn't change my consumer behavior at all. I simply filed disputes on December 12th. 2 years in a row. The first week after December 12th, they're probably still processing other disputes. The second and third week, the offices are either short-staffed or closed entirely. And the fourth week, everyone is overworked and undermotivated. December 25th might be Christmas, but December 12th is Credit Dispute Day. They have their holidays, I have mine. I want to be clear. I am not advising you to file fraudulent disputes, just disputes on what shouldn't actually be on your report. And this does not wipe away debt. If you owe some person or some company money, you still do. All this does is close the creditworthiness gap a bit between rich folks and people who were tricked into getting an Old Navy credit card when they were 22. I know, December 12th is a long way away, and you might want to try this sooner, and you can. Maybe there's just something going on in the world right now that would cause companies to be short-staffed. Good luck, my fellow disputers. And may the loans be ever in your favor. Thanks for following and subscribing on YouTube, Facebook, TikTok, Instagram, and Twitter. If you don't yet, please do. If you want to see videos like this before anybody else, make sure to join my Patreon at patreon.com/Steve Hofstetter. There's a bunch of exclusive things there also. And make sure to see a live show. I've got a huge tour this year, including Canada, Australia, tons of places in America, and all over everywhere else. Well, not everywhere else. You can check for yourself at stevehofstetter.com. Thanks for watching.